Thank you. can turn to the book of Jeremiah, the 4th chapter this morning, and we'll be putting some things up here on the board as well. Wow, there it is. How about that? Occasionally, technology works. But it takes a special anointing. I think this morning before service, we were having trouble with the camera in the other room and different things. It just seemed like everything was trying to cause it. You know, the enemy tries to do those things, but Jesus is greater. Amen?
Amen.
And so we're very, very thankful for that today. This morning, the book of Jeremiah, chapter 4 and verse 14, reads like this. How long shall thy vain thoughts lodge within thee? Now we could readapt the wording of that a little bit, and we could talk about how long shall our self-motivations, our self-thoughts, how long will they remain within us? Because as long as they're within us, there are areas that are problematic. And as I thought about this message today, the Lord helped me to bring it together in a way that I just turn, like, go back to that beginning slide, Celia. The title of this message, Games People Play with God. How many of you like to play games? Now, you're not going to admit to anything, are you? I know. I see efforts. They know when I ask something like that, there's a motive behind it. Games people play with God. Now, you know, there are games that we play with each other. There are games that we do together as groups or as friends. And we enjoy sporting events, the games of the different kinds of things. Those are okay. I'm not preaching against that, don't worry. Those are good things. But have you ever thought about the fact that for many people, the things of the Spirit, spiritual things with the Lord, or even the term called religion, and I really don't care for that term because it puts something in, injects something into it that I don't care for. But for the moment, let's say even things that are called in terms of religion, they're a game to be played for people. Now, I want you to think about this for a moment. For some, it's almost an exciting thing. You know, kind of like when you're playing a game with your friends and you're winning. It's kind of exciting. It's kind of fun. Or in an event and you're doing really well and it's exciting, motivational. And you get excited about that. But you know, I was reading from a quotation of a best-selling book some time ago. And the author says this, and I quote, "Most people in most of their family and business relationships are constantly playing games with each other. And yes, that comes into the church. Playing games. It's all too often the case. It's all too often the case with each other, and let me go so far as to say this morning that it can also be very much a part of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And this is where we get in danger. Jeremiah sensed it in his day. There was a lot of motion, and there was a very little reality in his time. And his generation wanted to be religious. But they did not want to be pure. They did not want to be holy. And they did not want to be separate. You know, some things don't change. Even though they should. This is the way it all too often is right here in the day that we live. People want to be accepted by God, and they want to enjoy the world at the same time. I want to know that I'm headed for heaven. I want to know that He's preparing a place for me. I want to know that my eternity is secure in glory one day. But in the meantime, while I'm here on this earth, I want to do my thing. And after all, He's a loving and a forgiving God, so, you know, I ought to be able to do that. And we get into this mindset. Jeremiah gave God's verdict on this kind of motivation. Jeremiah 7:28 says, "But thou shalt say unto them, this is a nation that obeyed not the voice of the Lord, their God, nor receiveth correction. Truth has perished and is cut off from their mouth." Jeremiah's generation convinced itself that it could play both ends towards the middle. They could be in the world and they could be in glory as well at the same time, and it was okay with God. There's a lot of people that think that today too. Jeremiah 7:9-10 says, "Will you steal? Will you murder? Will you commit adultery? Will you swear falsely and burn incense unto Baal and walk after other gods whom you know not, and come and stand before me in this house which is called in by my name, and say, we are delivered to do all these abominations?" In other words, it's okay. Will you do all these things and still come in before the Lord into the house of God and say, it's okay for us to do these things that the Lord has told us not to do? I want you to think about this. And in these next few moments, I want to talk to you about some of the games that people play with God. Games. Now, I'll have to give a little bit of explanation on some of these, because some of these come from some game shows that took place a few years ago. And matter of fact, there's a couple of them here that took place long before most of you were even born. So I'm dating myself, but I think you'll get the idea here. One of the game shows that used to be very popular, at least in the U.S., and I do know they did at least have a form of it here in some of the European countries, because I did a little resource on it. I forget what they called it, but the idea was somewhat the same. And that game was called Let's Make a Deal. Now, the way this game worked was there was a television host, and all these people came into the television audience, and they would dress in all kinds of weird things to draw attention to themselves. You know, colored feathers and hats and makeup and all kinds of weird things. And they wanted to draw attention to themselves because they wanted that television host to select them. So the game started even before the game began, because in the game they wanted to be selected. And if they could catch the attention of the host and he selected them, then they were drawn into this game called Let's Make a Deal. And after they were introduced and the guy talked to them for a little bit, he would come up with this thing where he would give them some kind of, usually a fairly nice prize. You know, and sometimes it was money, sometimes it was something. But it was always pretty nice. It would be kind of like if I walked over here to a dentist this morning and gave him a 100-year-old bill. Reggie's sitting there saying, yeah, do it. and then we talk a little bit more. And then pretty soon I said, now wait a minute, Dennis. I've got a deal for you. And what they would do, they would point to the stage, and on the stage there would be three doors, number 1, 2, and 3. And the host would say, do you want to keep that 100 euros that I just gave you, or would you like to trade it for one of these three doors and what's behind it? Now, nobody knew what was behind the door, and one of those doors usually had something really, really good. And the other two doors usually had kind of a weird, stupid price. Huh? Yeah, yeah, like a free meal of spaghetti on Piazza Roma, you know. I mean, something really strange. No, it was really dumb stuff a lot of times. But you see, you had to select one of the three doors, and whatever you selected, you gave up what you had, and you got what was behind that door. Some people went away very happy. Some people went away not so happy, because they selected the wrong door. And he would always, you know, try to get them to make a deal. You know, we like to play this game with God. Let me explain. Usually we like to play it when we're in trouble. You know, in honesty, I've been guilty of trying to do this myself. I've been tempted to do this myself at time to time. You know, when you're sick, you're really sick, you're really struggling, maybe you've got a really difficult disease or something physically very wrong with you, and maybe even the doctors are trying to figure out what in the world to do if you've been, or with some, but you're really, 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 really sick. Or financially, you're in trouble. You know, the rent's due, and all the different things that you have are responsible for is due, and you have almost no money in your bank account. Ever been there? Yeah, most of us can relate. Or you're hurting about something, you've been hurt by somebody or something very deeply, or you're unsure about what's ahead. And you find yourself in the position of talking to God, and you say, "Hey, God, let's make a deal." Now, you might not say that exactly, but in your prayers, you begin to bargain with God. To many people, this becomes almost a religion, a bargain hunter's game, and they're looking for the best deal possible. Let me remind you this morning, when God enters into an agreement with you, it is a contract. God does enter into agreements with you, and he does take it seriously. You know, when people say, "Well, you know, Lord, if you'll just take the pain away, you know, I'll increase my giving, or I'll pray more, or I'll be more faithful to church, or I'll do this, or I'll do this according to what your word says. If you'll just do this for me, I'll do these things." Have you ever been there? No one would admit to it, but probably all of us have been at least tempted. I know I have. Let me remind you about the contract. Don't bargain with God unless you are really serious. What I'm saying is, remember, God is prepared to listen to you. Just as he listened to Jacob. Genesis 28, 20 and 20, 22 says, "If God will be with me and keep in this way that I go and will give me bread to eat and clothing to put on so that I can again go into my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God, and this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God's house, and of all that you will give me, I will surely give a tenth unto God." You see the bargaining here? If you will do this, God, if you will do this, if you will do this, if you will do this, then I'll do what you told me to do to begin with. Now, my response to that is, why don't you just begin tithing and let the Lord show you the honors that obedience to start with? when people use it as a bargaining tool. Don't play games with God. He takes his agreements with you serious, and he expects you to do the same thing. Does he love you? Does he forgive you when you mess up? Yes, he's willing to do that. But there is a price to be paid when we put ourselves in these positions and then we don't do. When, in essence, we're dishonest with God. Be serious about any agreement that you enter into with the Lord. Game number two. Another favorite game people play with God is one called charades. Now, you probably all know what charades are, don't you? You know, it's you pretend to be someone and you ask people to identify the character that you assume, and you can't tell them, you can't verbally do it, you gotta
do this kind of thing.
You're trying to paint a picture that will help them understand who you are. You pretend to be someone you aren't, and you try to get people to guess who you are. So we make all these weird moves and all these weird motions. We sing, we pray, and we give. That's how we do it with God sometimes. We play the game of charades by singing, by praying, and by giving. But the real us, our heart is a million miles away. How many times have we all been guilty of sitting in the house of the Lord in a worship service, and the presence of God is there, and we're singing the words, but our mind is off someplace else? How many times have we been guilty about going through a worship service and going through the motions of church, and we're sitting there thinking about, man, I can't wait to get to lunch. I'm hungry. Wish the preacher would shut up so we could have coffee fellowship, because I know it's always good. You know, we've all been there. Or we're thinking about something else, or something else we're going to be doing, or some problem in our life, or something that's going on, and we're really not there. We're there physically, but emotionally connected with the Lord, we're not. We're almost like actors and actresses in the service. Jesus made a note of this, and he said in Mark 7:6, "These people honored me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." And Jesus looks at your heart. He's not interested in the motions that you go through in religion. He's not interested in that at all. He's interested in the heart that says, "Lord, I love you, and I want to serve you. And I want to be there with motions, parades, statistics, audiences, efforts are not enough. A lot of people have the idea, well, you know what? If I just go to church this Sunday, I've done my thing for Jesus this week, and he'll be really happy because I was there. He may be happy that you're there, but if your spirit, your mind, and everything else is someplace else, you haven't honored him. And you can't fool him. You may fool me. I'm not hard to fool. You may fool somebody else that's sitting next to you. But I want to tell you right now, the Lord knows your heart. People pretend. They pretend to participate. They pretend to pray. Sometimes they pretend to sing the songs. And especially if it's something they know very well. You know, you can watch them. They're saying the words, but it's almost like it's coming from a blank stare. There's no real worship. There's no connection. Let me tell you something. I know Dennis. I know myself, I know Pastor Amanda, Pastor Dow, all of us have one desire in our worship service, and that is that when we come together and worship the Lord, we connect with the Lord. We connect with Him. And we truly worship Him. We're not interested in entertainment. We're not interested in song service to say that we had one. We want to connect with Jesus. That's what it's all about. But sometimes people don't do that. They just go through the motions. And they struggle. Many times people play this game during even communion service. And God says in 1 Corinthians 11:28, let a man examine himself. We've all been guilty of going through the motions of church. And I've said for years when we began ICF back in 2010, I never want us to be found to be a church that goes through the motions of church. I want us to be people who love God, who give their best for the Lord, who understand God's call upon our life to be the light that is so desperately needed in this world today. He's saying we need to stop pretending. We need to examine ourselves. Sometimes people play games with giving. Ananias and Sapphira did. They were caught in it, and it cost them their life. Be aware that you can really get caught up, and you can really get into trouble assuming false identities with the Lord. Game number three, another favor, hide and seek. Everybody played hide and seek as a kid, right? Sometimes we play it as adults too. You know, when you're supposed to be doing something, working on the job, and your boss is looking for you, and you're trying to hide. Hide and seek. When it comes to this situation, it's like as long as we can hear God's voice calling, where are you? We feel everything will be okay. You know, we're not too far. Where are you, my child? Yeah, I hear you, God. I'm not too far. Where are you? So we go to some activity on Sunday instead of putting God first and count on hearing God's voice. Or do something else on Sunday evening or in midweek times, and we count on hearing God's voice, because as long as we can hear God's voice, it's okay, we're not too far away. We make the excuse, God understands. And in fact, when we say that, I don't think we realize we are speaking truth. He does understand, but He really understands because He really knows the motives and the reasons behind it. It's not this quick, easy excuse thing. Probably every person in this room this morning, either now or in the future or at some point in their life, you're concerned about earning money for now instead of souls for the kingdom. And we all have to make a living. Don't misunderstand me. I understand it. But there is this thing called faith that says, if I'm doing what God's called me to do, God takes care of me. Will it be stretched? Will it be challenged? You bet you will. Of course, it always. But God grows us. He grows us in us, these things. And we still have to understand, as we talk about so much of the time, every one of us has the call of God on our life as believers. Every person in this room, you say, no, you're the preacher. You have the call of God on your life. You've been called to be His witness. You've been called to be the light. God can use you to reach people that I will never even meet. You see, it's a multiplication thing. And it's very important. We all have that. You know, sometimes we're getting far enough away we can still hear, but there's a lot of distance. Have you ever stopped to think, what if God left you there? I don't know about you, but I can remember as a very small child playing McGehee hide and seek, and he was usually with other friends or family members. A lot of them are older, and I had this safety factor, you know, thinking, well, these are all my friends, they're my family, and, you know, I can go hide, and I may be quite a distance, but they're not going to just run off and leave me. I mean, they're going to find me if they have to. There was a safety factor. And I think some of that carries over in our relationship with the Lord. And what would it be? What would it be like if God just left you there? What if God didn't come looking for you? What would it be like if God were completely indifferent? If he didn't care? Remember, he kept on the trail of Peter. He said to him in Luke 22:32, I have prayed for you. Let me say to you this morning that you may hide, but God will find you. I can promise you that. God will find you. He found Jonah. He found Moses. Jonah hid in the Mediterranean, and Moses hid in Midian, but the eye of the Lord covered both lands and sea, and God found them. And he'll do the same for you today. David played games with God, but he discovered something. He said in Psalm 139:7-13, he said, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For the created, my innermost being, you created me, and you knit me together in my mother's womb. You see how special you are?
Amen.
Wow. You were wonderfully and specially created. God knows how to take care of his own. And he'll always come looking for you. Fourth and last game people play with God is called concentration. This one goes back a long way, but it's probably been rebirthed somehow or other. And it goes like this. Look, God, I'm religious. Look, God, I'm holy. Look at me. Think about this. The Pharisees were master players of this game. They fasted twice a week, they prayed long prayers, and they kept the count down to the penny. They went through all the right motions. They were careful about their religious experience. But Jesus said to them in Matthew 23:15, what sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you cross land and sea to make one convert, and then you turn that person into twice the child of hell you yourselves are. That's pretty strong terminology. That kind of shakes a person. You see, religion to the Pharisees was something of nothing more than total business. The motions of church. They brought into it real estate, they brought high rent, they brought expensive clothes, rich furnishings, choice menus, difficult rituals, complex study, and restricted degrees. It was really meant to be something to be a Pharisee. It was status. Jesus made note of this, Matthew 5:20, "For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter into the kingdom of heaven." In other words, you can play that game. You can make everybody around you think you're the most holy thing that ever set foot on the earth. But God knows what's here. And if this is not right, you're in no place good. You can be so religious and at the same time be so ungodly. This is a game millions of people play on Sunday morning. Understand, you may play the games with God, but God will never play the game with you. Your relationship with God is something deadly serious. Ultimately serious. God is not going to play games with you. You may pretend with others, but don't pretend with God. That's why I don't want anyone to play with my soul, and neither should you. That's why I tell you all the time, you need to know what the Word says. Don't you depend on a man to be your spiritual source on everything. You make sure that what that man is teaching you matches the Word of God. Because it's the Word of God that will make the difference. Don't play games with your soul. Don't endanger your eternity. Where I go to church, I want a service where I can hear from God. I can feel the presence of the Holy Spirit, and the Word of God will be held true. And that's our goal for ICF Florence. We want it to be true. You see, I still believe that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I get so uptight with everybody thinking they got to take this book, and well, yeah, it was, when this was done, it was pretty accurate, but you know, today's different. And so we need to readapt it. We need to make it fit 2016. The reality is we need to make our lives fit it, not try to make it fit our life. We need to understand. We don't want to be misled. We want to live by the Word of God and not try to make the Word of God something that it's not. I am on my way on a one-way trip to eternity, and I want the directions clear. Sometimes you ask directions around here, you know, they don't know what to tell you, so they just say, simply to me. Always go straight. Now, how many of you can find a straight street in one of these cities? They used to tell us that in Rome, and right ahead of us was a piazza intersection with 10 streets going out from, I think. How do you go straight through that? Doesn't make sense. Sometimes we're just as bad about that with our relationships with the Lord. I want clarity. I want to know, because I'm on a very important trip. I want the church to prepare me for that day when I must stand before God and give an account. And trust me, everyone will do that. Jeremiah came to Judah, and there was only one way. Jeremiah 7:3 says, "This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says, reform your ways and your actions, and I will let you live in this place." It's my desire that those of us here at ICF Florence, whether you're here long term or whether you're here for one Sunday or whatever the situation might be, I want us to take to heart and live by the Word of God. We all have eternity before us. This is a non, uh, this is not something that you can choose not to participate in. You will have eternity before you. The only example choice is, where will that eternity be? Where and how will you spend it? How will you depend on it? How you spend your eternity will depend upon how you live and deal with your relationships with Jesus Christ and His Word now. So I want to encourage you today. Let's stop being guilty of playing games with God. Let's prepare our hearts. Let's prepare our lives. If we find ourselves in these kinds of positions and things, can we be honest with the Lord and say, Lord, you know, I've been doing this, or I've not been doing that, or I've been calling something that if what it's really not, and Lord, I know you know it anyhow, but I ask you today, forgive me. I repent of that. I don't want to go there anymore. I want to be genuine. I want to be a real believer. I want to be a genuine light in the darkness. I don't want to play games because, Lord, you're too important to me. And my eternity is too important to me. And there's only one way I want to spend it, and that's in the presence of Jesus. That's what it comes down to. Where are you going to do it? And if you're sitting there today and the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you and saying, you know what? There's a couple of things here that maybe we need to think about and talk about. It may be something that you're not even aware of. Or it may be things that you've been aware of, but you just kind of let them get buried. You know, the enemy's real good at cloaking things, covering them up, until you kind of forget about them. Please don't let him beat you up and make you feel worthless over that. You are human. God created you that way. But he also gave you the ability to come before him and let him change your heart and change your life. Set you free and put you in the right place with him. That's the goal. That's the goal. Would you stand with me right now? Hallelujah. Change my heart, oh God. You know it's singing. Make it ever true. Change my heart. I want to know that my eternity is secure. It begins, first of all, God wants you to spend eternity with Him. He's not going to put you in a position where it's too hard for you to make it. Lord, forgive me. Cover me in your forgiveness. Set me free. And recognizing that He is the way, the only way. It's not what you do, how you do it. It's not earning points. It's not about church attendance and keeping track and doing this and doing that. Those things are important, very important. But they're not going to be, you can be a part of some of those things and never, ever, ever miss. And you won't make it into eternity with Jesus. You see the hard stuff in your lives. You got to be covered in the blood of the Lamb. Is there anyone this morning, no one's looking around, who want to pray for you? Anyone here today, in either room, back or front, and you would be honest and say, you know what? I don't know really where I'm at with God. Or maybe you know it's not a good place. Maybe you see yourself playing some of these games. And you simply want to say, Lord, cleanse me today and set me free. I want to be everything you created me to be because I want to be your light in a lost world. I want to know my eternity is secure with you. And I receive you, Jesus, right now. I receive your forgiveness and I receive your love. And I give thanks for it. If that's you today, lift up a hand right now. Come on. I want to pray for you. Yes. Others? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anyone in the back room? I need the forgiveness of the Lord today. I want to know that my eternity is in heaven with Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Is there anyone else, Pastor Amanda? Yes. Hallelujah. I want to know I'm glory bound with the Lord. I want to know that He's preparing a place. I want to know I'm forgiven. You know what? He wants you to know that. He never intended for you to play another game called eternity guessing game. Am I saved? Am I not saved? Am I going to make it? Am I not going to make it? No. He wants you to have His assurance and His love. Hallelujah. Several have raised their hands. I'm going to ask us all right now to pray a prayer together. And if you pray this prayer and you mean it from your heart, I want you to know, no matter what the devil tries to tell you, you're glory bound. You're in the presence of the Lord. He loves you. He's covering you. Would you repeat with me, dear Jesus? Come on, say it out. Dear Jesus, I love you today. And I thank you for salvation. You are my salvation. And I thank you, Lord. Cover me in your precious shed blood.
Cover me in your precious shed blood.
Forgive my sins.
Forgive my sins.
Set me free.
Set me free.
Make me a light.
Make me a light.
Help me not to play games.
Help me not to play games.
But help me to be a true believer.
Help me to be a true believer.
That others will see you in my life.
That others will see you in my life.
I confess you, Lord.
My Lord,
my Savior,
my Jesus,
and my soon coming King. Amen. Come on, let's praise Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One more question. Now I'm going to speak to believers. How's your game on? Do you see yourself in some of these things? Have you been guilty of it? In reality, I don't see how any of us can say we haven't. The Lord wants to do something in your heart today. Because He doesn't want you playing games. He wants you to be on the winning side. All the time. All the time. And if you've been guilty of some of these things, okay, simply say, Lord, I don't want to go there anymore. I will be true to you. If that's you today, would you just lift your hand right now? Come on, lift both hands. I will lift both mine, but one has a microphone, so I'll lift both. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And pray this prayer with me as well. Lord Jesus, help me to be true to your word.
I want to live my life true to you.
I don't want to play games with you, God.
I want to be a believer.
And I want that belief to shine through my life.
I want people to look at me
and see you, Lord Jesus. My trust.
My faith.
You are my Lord.
You are my Lord.
You are my King.
Change my heart.